NATO, the West's post-World War II military alliance, is at an evolutionary crossroads. It must adapt or die. NATO's 28 member states are striving to define a new strategic concept suited to a world of unconventional threats, economic uncertainty, and a shift of global power to the East. My guest today, Kurt Volker, was, till recently, US ambassador to NATO. Is it time to accept that NATO's day is done? Kurt Volker, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thanks for having me.
There is right now an awful lot of talk about redefining NATO's role. But is not the truth that NATO is a Cold War construct and it's never going to be the right vehicle for 21st century challenges?
No, I don't think that's right. You know, if you go back and look at the original NATO treaty from 1949, the heart of it is the idea of collective defense, that as members of an alliance, we come to each other's defense in case we face security threats.
Collective defense of Europe.
Exactly. Of the North Atlantic area.
Yes.
And what we have today is continuing security threats. They're different than the ones that we had during the Cold War, different than the Soviet Union, but they nonetheless exist, and we have to deal with them. In fact, NATO's been more active in recent years than was during the Cold War.
But when the architecture of NATO was designed, there was not a thought in anybody's head that NATO forces would be deployed many, many thousands of miles away from the theater, that is, Western Europe and the Atlantic region.
No, that's exactly right. That's because no one thought back in 1949 that what could happen in a country in Afghanistan, landlocked, poor, tribal, would actually affect the security of the United States or of Great Britain or of Spain or any of the number of countries where our security has been directly affected.
And you've taken me straight to Afghanistan, and that's really where I want to start, because Madeleine Albright and this group of experts, Albright being the former US Secretary of State, of course, they have said in their recent report, looking at the strategic concept that must drive NATO's future, they've said that NATO has to be ready in the future to deploy pretty much anywhere in the world if it is to be relevant. Afghanistan's the test bed, the case in question, and NATO has not got it right in Afghanistan.
Well, there's several things I want to comment on here. The first is the question of relevance. The fact is that we look to NATO to take on security challenges that we feel need to be addressed. So we're not pushing it into a global role, permanent, all time, everywhere. But where our nations feel that we have an interest and a requirement to protect our security, NATO's acting. So, for instance, it has taken on the peacekeeping missions in Bosnia and Kosovo, delivered humanitarian assistance in Pakistan after the earthquake there. It's gone after pirates off the coast of Somalia. And of course, it's doing Afghanistan because of the threats there. So I think it's relevant to dealing with security challenges that our societies face.
Well, I can see that it can do some of those things and has done those things. But there are other vehicles that could do those things, arguably in a more acceptable way to everybody looking in at NATO from the outside. I mean, the United Nations, for example, does have the ability to deliver military force. We see it in, for example, Congo. We see it alongside the African Union in Sudan. It doesn't have to be NATO in these other parts of the world that are not directly relevant to the theater of original operation.
No, but actually it has to be somebody. I mean, the UN doesn't have standing forces. The UN calls upon states or organizations or whomever to help carry out the mandates of the UN. And in fact, NATO in Afghanistan is under a UN mandate. So it is very much part of what NATO does is working to deal with these security challenges as, in many ways, an implementing mechanism.
Well, let's get to Afghanistan specifically then. On this program, in this chair, just the other day, we had Mark Sedwill, who is now the top civilian envoy for NATO in Kabul. And he was very frank with me, and he said, you know, for many years, NATO has not got Afghanistan right, which does raise serious questions when Afghanistan is supposed to be the model for NATO's future operations.
Yeah, I think that there's a lot of validity in that statement. And it's not so much in the concept as in the execution. If you look at the strategy we have for Afghanistan today, we talk about a comprehensive approach or a counterinsurgency strategy. It's based on several pillars that we actually have to defeat the Taliban where they're fighting, but bring the local population on side, strengthen civilian implementation and governance, build the lasting structures that are going to make a difference. We've said this last year at the Strasbourg summit. We said this at the Bucharest summit in 2008. We did it in a strategy review under the Bush administration in late 2008. But the fact is, we've never resourced the strategy.
And with great respect, the one thing you haven't pointed out, which is the real difference and why now maybe the counter-terror operation stands a chance of success, which it didn't before, is because the United States has put tens of thousands of troops on the ground. I think the U.S. Deployment now is close to 90,000. It'll soon be 100,000.
Right.
Dwarfs any other deployment. Next come the British with 10,000 troops at most. Mm-hmm. That's the reality, that Afghanistan is now America's war, and NATO is, frankly, nothing more than a fig leaf.
America's providing the bulk of the resources because America can. And Britain, we all know, is feeling that it's at the maximum of what it's able to do. European allies feeling they can do even less. But no one wants
That's the reality I'm striving to get you to address, that in the end, when we talk of NATO and its deployments out of area, it only can possibly work if, frankly, it is a U.S. deployment with the others providing a fig leaf.
Well, I think that mischaracterizes the operation in Afghanistan in the sense that we're all there for many of the same reasons, that it's important to the people of Afghanistan, their security counts. It's important to the region, Pakistan and elsewhere. We need stability there. What happens in Afghanistan can have a direct impact on our own security, and either we make progress in calming the waters of extremism that exist in the world, or if we don't succeed in Afghanistan, we throw fire on them.
Well, all of that may be true, but it's still the United States that has the military capacity, the economic resources, and the will to make it happen. And that's why I wonder whether all of this talk about NATO and its ability to deliver around the world can ever really make sense. Look at the realities, economic realities as much as anything else in Europe, and the spend on defense. It simply isn't going to be joint operations.
I think in the short term, there's no prospect that defense spending is going to increase in Europe. I think we just have to recognize that with the financial crisis and the economic crisis we've got. Europe, however, does spend an awful lot of money on defense. And the question is it being spent in ways that can make the greatest contribution to our common security? And it was on, I think it was the BBC Today program this morning, a figure of 2 million men at arms still, and yet difficulty deploying more than about 60,000. That's a change from when I was working for Lord Robertson, when we used to say 40,000, but it's still a small percentage of the available resources that could be there under Europe's command.
Sure, but I know as well as you do that when you were U.S. ambassador to NATO, you spend an awful lot of your time arguing, at least trying to persuade other member states to front up and provide more troops, more resources to key areas like Afghanistan, and you failed. And I'm wondering why you believe you're going to have greater success in the future.
No, we didn't fail. We actually saw a substantial increase in European forces in Afghanistan, both during the time that I was there and also the time that my successor has been there.
But with respect, most of those forces weren't fighting. They were maybe doing some training, some other valuable work, but they were not fighting. And those that were fighting, I'm thinking now of the Dutch and the Canadians, have now put time limits on how long their troops are going to stay. They'll both be out by the end of 2011.
It's been a mixture. We had troops that were fighting, and you could expand on your list of the Canadians and the Dutch to include the Danes, of course the British, Poles, even Estonians. And at the same time, you could point to others that were in more calm parts of Afghanistan, such as the Italians or Germans. And the Germans, frankly, are in the north, where it is becoming more challenging, and they're taking on roles that they hadn't expected to have to take on.
I suppose, in the end, though, if you asked Afghans, you know, who is it that is in your country as a foreign fighting force, you know, and is committed to staying in your country to continue the fight against the Taliban, most of them would say it's the Americans, or it's Americans and the Brits, or Americans and their allies.
Right.
They don't really see this as a NATO operation, and internationally it's not really perceived as so much a NATO operation as a US-dominated operation, and that's a problem.
Well, I agree with you. I think that it's a problem if that's the perception in terms of the politics and the international community's commitment. It's a reality on the ground that the U.S. is providing the resources. But when you look at the U.N. mandate around the operations, if you look at the London conference that was held here about donations to support civilian reconstruction, if you look at the EU's role in Afghanistan, there's a whole lot going on. But there is this perception that it's an American military effort. I think it's important for all of us, both for the United States and also for our allies, that we make clear that this is actually an international community that's concerned about security and concerned about the situation there, and we're all chipping in.
But without a common view. And if we broaden this out and not just talk about Afghanistan, but consider NATO and Iran, for example, what we see is, while America has a certain line on Iran, and right now the Obama administration is talking about tough new sanctions that, to quote the president, bite on Tehran, we have other NATO member states like Turkey who are very actively involved in diplomatic efforts involving deals on shipping out uranium and processing it overseas, which are specifically designed to avoid sanctions being placed upon Iran. Again, suggests that NATO isn't really a viable vehicle for these sorts of challenges.
I think there's potential for NATO there, but you're quite correct in saying NATO has not been the vehicle where we've talked about Iran policy and made decisions together. It has been the EU3, so the UK, France, and Germany, working together with the other members of the Security Council, which include then Russia, China, and the US, to develop UN resolutions that apply sanctions, and then sanctions applied nationally or through EU or other means. China and Russia need to as well. We've had three unanimous UN Security Council resolutions applying sanctions on Iran. We're in discussions on a fourth one, and in fact very close with the UK, British, French, Germans, others. So we are very close to another resolution.
But if you accept, as I do, that Iran is one of the great security challenges facing the international community and the West, is it not worrying that NATO's stance is internally divided? Well, some would say incoherent.
Well, I think you would find a number of NATO countries, including, you know, allies like the French, who would say bringing NATO in a prominent role in dealing with the Iran question would seem to over-militarize our approach. And they're looking at a diplomatic and a sanctions-based solution. So we've been participants and active participants in that diplomatic and sanctions-based approach to try to get Iran to change its policy. I want to come to Turkey now, because with Turkey, on the one hand, I am very skeptical of what this deal means, but we need to see more of the details. We need to see what comes in, what goes out, is there full transparency, does the IAEA have full access, who provides the low-enriched uranium, have they committed to stop all enrichment? There's a lot of ifs and questions about
this. Sure, and you speak if I may say so, a U.S. foreign policy expert, a Bush appointee to a top ambassadorial job, and that in a way is the problem. You say you're skeptical. The Prime Minister of Turkey, Erdogan, declares, and I'm quoting him, there will now be no need for sanctions. You know, there's a different perception from Ankara as opposed to Washington, and it gets to the heart of what I continue to say to you is a problem at the heart of NATO.
Well, again, I don't want to put this in Turkey-US terms, because it's something that's gone through the UN several times. It's gone through the IAEA, which is a massive international organization. It's not as if the concerns that the international community has concerning Iran's programs are unclear. What is unclear at this point is what is inside this Turkish-Iranian deal. We need to see more of the details. And let me add, if I could, that I think if Iran does want to give up its nuclear program and wind down, it's going to need some kind of diplomatic vehicle. It would be out of character to just capitulate to the United States or to the EU3 or to the UN Security Council. So there are potential roles for a country like Turkey or others who can help Iran climb down. What we just need to see is whether this is such an effort or not. At this point, I think Iran is much more likely just trying to break the consensus on sanctions in the UN.
A final thought on NATO's future out-of-area activities. Is it conceivable to you that NATO could ever, ever be the vehicle for military action against Iran?
I don't think that you would see affirmative or aggressive military action taken by NATO. NATO is a defensive alliance. What you do see within NATO is development of a program on missile defense. Well, whose missiles are we talking about? We're talking about the possibility of Iran sending missiles toward European territory. And so NATO is talking about missile defense.
Let's stick with missile defense, because I now want to talk to you about Russia. When Madeleine Albright and people like you say NATO has a future, but it is a future which is outward looking and has to be ambitious about the scope of its operations, there are many inside NATO who say, whoa, hang on a minute. You know, we've got real problems inside the NATO area, and our biggest problem is that we, and I'm thinking now of East European states in particular, we still deeply mistrust the motives of Russia.
Right.
And that's where NATO should be focusing its effort, not on Iran, Afghanistan, or anywhere else.
I think it's got to be a combination. The fact that Russia invaded Georgia weighs on the minds of countries in Central and Eastern Europe, especially the Baltic states, who want to feel assured that their security is not going to be at risk. So NATO has a role in providing that kind of reassurance to all the members of the alliance inside the Atlantic
area.
But
what kind of reassurance will it be when you, Kurt Volker, as ambassador at NATO for the United States, were one of the strongest critics of Russia's military activities when they sent major force into Georgia, and we now see that far from removing those forces as desired, mm-hmm. they acceded to the breakup of Georgia. We have the sort of seceded state of Abkhazia mm-hmm. and South Ossetia. NATO, far from making that front and center of the relationship with Russia and getting mm-hmm. very tough about it, mm-hmm. has essentially brushed it under the carpet.
It's a bit strong to say it's brushed under the carpet. We suspended the NATO-Russia Council for a time.
Yeah, for a very short time?
Well, for several months. You know,
well, until that the must have really hurt
about
Moscow.
6 minutes.
I mean, well, then, do you see the point
I'm making? No, of course I see the point that you're making. And then when we resumed the NATO-Russia Council, we made it very clear that we're going to try to work together because it's in our interest as NATO, as the United States, to try to work together with Russia where we have areas of convergence of interests. But we're also going to raise areas where we disagree, and one of those being, of course, Georgia. Now, it's, of course, a shame that Russia has not implemented the EU ceasefire agreement going back to the end of the war. Monitors are not getting in. It is occupying these territories and has broken them off. And I think that needs to be something that we continue to raise.
Well, here's the words of Ron Asmus, who I'm sure mm-hmm. you know well, who's now mm-hmm. at the German Marshall Fund, used to be a senior administration official. Asmus says, Russia has embraced policies and a military doctrine that places NATO as the top external military danger to them and justifies the right to intervene in neighboring countries. While packaged in smooth diplomatic language, President Dmitry Medvedev's new proposal for pan-European mm-hmm. security has the less than hidden goal of stopping and rolling back Western influence.
Right. I think that the Russians have actually been very clear about their intentions here. They've talked about a sphere of influence around themselves, their right of say-so over neighboring countries. They have invaded Georgia.
And we've allowed that to stand. And we now say we want, to quote Madeleine Albright in her recent report, we want a new partnership. We want new levels of cooperation with them, despite all of this.
Well, I think we're trying to do two things at the same time. We're hedging and we're protecting ourselves. I should say three things: hedging and protecting ourselves.
Yeah, hedging. Hedging, you say, and that doesn't sound too good if you sit in Estonia or Latvia or a host of other countries which happen to be very close to Russia.
Hedging meaning that we do military exercises, we do operational plans for the defense of all the NATO allies. These are things that have been stepped up in the last couple of years. At the same time, we do provide support to our neighbors, which are also Russia's neighbors, Ukraine, Georgia, others.
Well, what support are you offering to Georgia? You know, they desperately want the real commitment to a membership action plan so they can get inside NATO. That has been swept away. Nobody believes that's going to happen.
Now, the membership action plan is off the table for now. It's clear. But that doesn't mean...
Why?
Why? Because there are a number of NATO members who don't believe that Georgia should become a NATO member and isn't ready for it, whether through political reform...
You just said it. NATO internally divided on this key issue.
NATO makes decisions by consensus.
And there is no consensus. And you told me, going back to the beginning of this interview, that absolutely NATO is fit for purpose in the 21st century. We now decide on one crucial strategic issue about its relationship with the big neighbor, Russia. It's completely unable to act.
Right. No, I am not disagreeing with you. I'm saying, for example, on Russia, NATO is very divided. There are basically three ideas concerning Russia that exist simultaneously among NATO members. There is the Central and East Europeans who want to be protected from Russia. There are the...
And they want NATO to be all about that protection, rather than worrying too much about what it's doing in Afghanistan.
Well, let's come back to that. The second is that the West Europeans want strategic engagement with Russia for reassurance. And then there's the United States, which I think looks at Russia from a global strategic perspective and say we need to work together, for example, on Iran and reducing nuclear weapons. None of these three views of Russia is wrong. They need to be integrated into a...
They are internally contradictory, which is a little bit of a problem for NATO.
They're not internally contradictory. You can do all of these because you do have to provide the protection and the assurance for countries in the East.
You need to be a heck of a contortionist to do all of those.
No, I don't think so. You just need to have a strategy, which is what the strategic concept document and the effort within NATO is all about.
Are you sure it's not just papering over cracks? That's what strikes me.
No, well, it would be papering over cracks if we didn't go through the effort of knocking our heads together And if you do that within the alliance, you can have the West Europeans respecting the concerns of the East Europeans. You can have the United States respecting the need to engage Russia at a local level as well as at a strategic level. You can have the Central Europeans feeling more reassured if their defense is clear, so that they're willing, therefore, on that basis, to try to engage Russia more themselves.
Interesting.
It fits together if you put it together.
Well, you say so. Interesting that you there acknowledge that on this issue there is a difference actually between the West Europeans and Washington. I just wonder if we can bring it to the UK for a moment. Mm-hmm. Are you worried that the UK now has a coalition government, one part of which, the Liberal Democrats, have made a great point of saying that in the recent past, the UK relationship with Washington has been subservient, has been slavish, and should never be like that again?
Yeah, no, that's been a leitmotif coming out of a lot of the political debate here in the UK. I'm not terribly worried about it, which was your question. I think that with the Tory Lib Dem coalition that's come into office, we're going to have a very strong team, and we're going to be able to work with the UK very well.
Well, a strong team, you say, but Nick Clegg, who you know now is Deputy Prime Minister and an important player in the government, has talked about the embarrassing reliance that Britain has had on the quote-unquote special relationship. Britain's acted as an echo for music set in the White House and the Pentagon for too long, he says.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that this is all UK domestic politics, frankly.
Yeah, but that, you know, we're talking about NATO here, and
well,
it matters
if
an important member like the United Kingdom is beginning to assess its relationship with Washington in a different way. That matters. Yeah. And, you know, we've had William Hague going to see Hillary Clinton and saying, yes, he wants a good relationship, but it will be solid, not slavish.
And that's no change. There hasn't been a slavish relationship. I think what we've seen is a perception that because Britain went to war in Iraq, that therefore the UK was acting slavishly, and it wouldn't have ever done that if it hadn't been acting slavishly. When in fact, you had a prime minister who believed it was the right thing to do. He even told the Iraq inquiry that not long ago, given the chance, it was still the right decision and he would do it again. And it was backed up by a vote of parliament at the time.
Sure, but Tony Blair always made it plain that a big factor in his thinking was the degree to which it was very important for Britain to stick with its ally in Washington. Blair believed that breaking that alliance would be a terrible mistake for Britain.
I'm sure that's true, but that wasn't the main reason, as well as I understood it. The main reason was very much the one that motivated the U.S. as well, so we shared an assessment, which is the risk that weapons of mass destruction would fall into the hands of terrorists was the greatest security threat that we had, and we saw Iraq as a problem in that area. So the decision was difficult in the days after 9/11, but eventually both the U.S. and U.K. decided it was worth trying to remove Saddam Hussein from power to remove that risk.
You were, if I may, just before we end, you were at NATO under President George W. Bush. There's a very different president in the White House now.
Yeah, I was there about equal time.
Okay, 50-50. But frankly, you were probably on your way out when Obama came, it's fair to say. With President Obama, who we believe in Europe looks primarily to the rise of the Asian economies, who has a different take on the world from George W. Bush, do you really believe he cares as much about the future of NATO?
I think he does care. And I was with him at the NATO summit in Strasbourg, for example. And I know that he spoke passionately there, including at a town hall meeting in Strasbourg, about the alliance and about the roles that we play in the world. So I think he does believe that. What comes up is a point that you made earlier, a perception that it's not working very well and that the capacities aren't there and the will is not there. And that's why you see this push to try to fix NATO. How can we define the concept better? How can we bring our political systems and people and political will behind it? Can we mobilize more resources? If we can't do that, I think it diminishes in interest over time for the U.S., whether that's a Democratic or a Republican president.
Kurt Volker, we have to end it there, but thank you very much for being
on
Hard Talk.
My pleasure.
Thanks very much indeed.